morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is Terry Wooster, Public Information Officer for the Department of Public Safety. We're here at the EOC for the daily briefing. I'm sorry it's a few minutes late. On the briefing today, we will have Governor Dennis Stuttgart, Eric Stosch of the Army Corps of Engineers, Mayor Lori Gill from Pierre, Mayor Sam Tidball from Fort Pierre. We also have available, if there are questions, Christy Terman, Director of the Office of Emergency Management for South Dakota, Mark Nouveau, Federal Coordinating Officer of Corps FEMA. Governor Stuttgart will open. Go ahead, Governor.
All right, well, thank you again for coming. Thank you for your patience as we are about a half hour late getting this press conference going. As I said when I walked into the room to a few of you, we've been busy doing, and so now we want to tell you what we've been doing. But it doesn't change the fact that doing must be our first priority. There has been progress on all fronts, and I'm very pleased with the great cooperation that we're seeing from so many. Individuals are taking personal responsibility, taking action in self-reliance upon their needs. As I drove through the Pierre, Fort Pierre communities this morning, I saw many homes buttoned up, completely evacuated. The spirits, I think, are heightened beyond what they were I was seeing some despair in days ago. I passed one house that said, a for sale indoor pool. I passed another house that said no fishing, no wake. And I passed a third house that had a boat anchor on the roof. So people are working hard to take care of themselves, but they're also remembering the importance of keeping everything in perspective, remembering that we have not lost any lives yet, and I hope that remains true. We had an accident in the Dakota Dunes area yesterday where an individual struck a volunteer with their bobcat, an individual working to protect their own property struck an individual with a bobcat and broke their legs, plural. I don't know any more than that, but it reminds us all that we need to be careful and safety first, safety first. I want to thank individuals that are taking action, and also the governments that are working so well together. Mark from FEMA was here with me last night, and the utilities director from Fort Pierre talking about the protective measures that Fort Pierre is undertaking, and how the federal partnership can or may be available to help them. And Colleen, his counterpart, was also with him. Christy has been here, Christy Terman, running the state office, has been here early, working late. She's not only managing the Fort Pierre Pier event, but the Dakota Dunes event, the Yankton impacts of potential tornadoes that were here two nights ago. So it's a big job, and she's got strength, and we really are lucky to have her leadership here. I want to begin with, again, a statewide observation. Yesterday, we received formal word from the president that he approved our request we made a couple of days ago to add Stanley County to the disaster declaration. We had incurred enough damage in Stanley County to add it to Hughes County. They both have formal disaster declarations, means there's been enough damage already. Downstream, we've also received formal approval from the president that authorizes emergency protective measures in Clay County, Yankton County, and Union County. That recognizes that the damages have not yet occurred to the degree that we might qualify for a disaster. If and when that does occur, then we'll seek a disaster declaration for those counties as well. But the emergency protective measures helps us look to FEMA and other federal partners for federal assistance to protect against the occurring flood conditions. I next want to move to Yankton and visit a little bit about Yankton. Yesterday we described an area, a residential area in Yankton, that may have some impacts. Our IMAT team members have been coordinating with the affected homeowners. They were there yesterday. They'll be again today talking to the homeowners and helping them understand the degree to which they are affected. In Dakota Dunes, it's a much larger project. The most difficult aspect of Dakota Dunes is the scale. We have 1,100 residences in there. Just looking at the water inundation maps, perhaps 800 are going to be affected, more or less, possibly more. The problem with Dakota Dunes is, like many modern residential developments, the street design is created to restrict traffic in and out and to slow traffic once it's in. And while that is good for human safety, it is not good for truck movement as we work urgently to build the dikes. The Army Corps of Engineers added additional personnel from Omaha, and they are actively engaged in levee design and construction in the dunes. And we are making progress, but it's a tall order. And so we're working very hard to accommodate the contractor's needs to get in and out of the development with loaded trucks. I mentioned yesterday that I had ordered some Black Hawk helicopters to the area. Two arrived yesterday afternoon and have been actively moving large sandbags into areas, the Bay Hill area and the area south of Spyglass Circle, the riverside of Spyglass Circle and the Bay Hill area, and that will continue. We've asked for a third Black Hawk and are looking to see that if we can speed that up still further. As I mentioned earlier, all six of South Dakota's Black Hawks have been mobilized federally and sent overseas. We have 247 National Guard soldiers in the dunes, both airmen and soldiers. They are sandbagging. They are working to protect infrastructure in a variety of ways. If you think about it, most of the houses near the river take their rainstorm collection and outlet to the river. And as much as that is a way to get water out of the development, as the water rises on the river, it will bring water into the development. So every one of those outlets to the river has to be found, identified, and plugged. Same with all storm sewers that flow to the river. Once the river rises, the water can come back up those storm sewers and flood homes, streets. We need to plug all the storm sewer outlets going to the river so the river can't back up through them and flood us from the inside rather from the outside. Airmen and soldiers are helping with that. Also with sandbagging, they're working on protecting public infrastructure, water treatment, and wells, and they are assisting where they can with the levee construction. In the Fort Pier area, you will see some activity north of Fort Pier on 1806, the Corps is undertaking with its own equipment a shaping of the spillway as a precautionary measure. We don't anticipate or plan to use the spillway, but as I mentioned, in every good plan, you always assume the worst. Assume the worst and plan for it. So we are going to assume that it might happen. We don't believe it will, but we'll assume the worst and plan to, and the Corps is planning to grade between 1806 and campground number 3 to assure that if the spillway does end up being used, that water will find its way into the river without spreading into areas which have been developed in the northern part of Fort Pier. So you'll see that activity commencing today to shape the spillway. The National Guard's completed its berm near the Ramcota, and they're also going to complete a partially constructed sandbag barrier at the top end of Steamboat Island. They're going to be working today and through the night, and we expect that to be completed by tomorrow morning. I will be meeting with law enforcement today now as we approach the date when water flows will increase. I'll be meeting with law enforcement to talk about evacuation measures. As the water flow increases, we want to be sure we protect human life as we evaluate how the levees are doing, how fast the water is being released, and whether those areas are going to be safe or not. We cannot depend on it. And so safety first is our concern. And so I'll be meeting with law enforcement about how to and when and to what extent we evacuate areas that are threatened. That's the overall picture as I see it. And I'll turn it over to Eric for a more specific report on levee construction and the dam here in the Pier Fork Pier area.
Okay, I'll begin with the construction update for the pier side of the levee construction. Progress on the pier side is good. We believe that 95% of the levees are above our base contract elevation right now and nearing the additional 2 foot that we were putting on top for the increased flows. So pier is looking real good. The reason pier is going to be in front of Fort Pier is because pier is an easier build. Piers are mainly on streets and easier access for the contractor, so it's obviously going to show that he's farther along in pier than Fort Pier. In Fort Pier, about two-thirds of the levee construction is up to that base elevation for the base contract, and we're still working on about a third of that to get that up to that base elevation. We still have 2 foot to go on top of that to get to our amended amount for the 2 foot buffer on top of where we think the flows are going to be. Some of those areas in that base two-thirds are obviously a little bit above, but we're still working on that. So there's a lot of effort right now to make sure that we meet our schedule, and we're still on schedule for 11 o'clock tomorrow night for completion of that base contract.
Okay, Eric, thanks. Now we'll move to the city reports, beginning with Pier. Lori?
All right, I'm Pier Mayor Lori Gill. Progress is happening in the city of Pier. Anybody that looks around can see that there's movement, there's trucks and equipment moving around, which the citizens are very glad to see. We want to remain safe. Safety of people in our community is first and foremost as we're making our decisions. I would like to remind people that as you're moving around the community, there are continual changes in traffic flow to be able to accommodate the trucks and the equipment that's moving around. So as construction is moving along in different places regarding the levee work, you may see changes in traffic flow, changes in stop sign locations, that kind of thing. So be aware as you're driving around the community. Be thinking about what you're doing and awareness of what's around you. As we've heard, dirt work on the earthen levees is moving along, and work will commence today on the installation of the plastic liner on the water side of the levees. So citizens will be seeing that. The portion of the levees that have large sandbags as a part of it, they're being reinforced now today, and that's happening at the wastewater treatment plant. We continue to secure that so that the wastewater system in our community remains functional as we're moving throughout this flooding event. Further on, utilities. Electric system in Pier, we're confident that it will be able to continue throughout the flooding event. Electricity will remain on as long as we can keep it on. If there is a specific health safety issue in a targeted area, such as a neighborhood that is flooded, we will make decisions based on health safety issues, whether or not to discontinue electricity at that specific location. But once again, electricity will largely remain on through this event in the community. The storm sewer system, work continues today to secure the storm sewer system in Pier. The storm sewers are also being plugged here in Pier to prevent the water from coming up on the dry side of the levees. A levee security plan is in place to provide for the people that need to depend on those levees. We need to secure and maintain the levee throughout the flooding event. We need to have access to it. So the security plan is going to allow us to help officers to identify those that need access to the levee system and be able to quickly identify those that don't. It is important to us that once the levee is up, that it remains secure. There are a variety of city buildings and public facilities that we continue to work on to secure and prevent flooding. An example would be the maintenance building at the city golf course, city hall. We have a number of buildings that we're working on to make sure that they remain secure throughout this event. Sandbagging continues in the city of Pierre. In Pierre, we have it going on at the landfill baling facility, Georgia Morris Middle School. We have an operation at Cone Ag that has been providing sandbags for securing public facilities. And there's other locations throughout the community where we're dropping free sand. We are starting to see sandbagging operations slow down somewhat from where they have been. But at this point right now, there still is plenty of sand, plenty of sandbags, and hauling services for those who still need them. Hillsview Golf Course is now closed, along with Steamboat and Griffin Parks. The Golf Board will meet next Monday to discuss further operational considerations regarding the golf course. Keep your eye on the city website for any information and changes in any city programming. We do have the Park and Rec area changing minute by minute in terms of location of summer rec programming, and the city website's a good place to go for that up-to-date information on an ongoing basis. There are groups talking as we speak on consideration of longer term housing issues. We have folks in the community that have campers and RVs and are wondering where they can go on the long term if they need to. We will be announcing within the day where some of those locations are so that people can make plans in that respect. And lastly, I have been told that there is a federal government boat from the USGS that will be out on the water periodically. It'll be out there today and once a week going on into the future. It will be clearly marked. It's supposed to be there. It will be there to be able to get visuals of what's going on. So public, if you see that boat out there, once again, it will be marked USGS. And it is has been given clearance to be on the water. And that is the Pierre report.
Okay, Sam Tidball, Fort Pierre. Levee work, as indicated on the core project, is progressing, and we remain optimistic that that levee will be in place in Fort Pierre, ready for the higher water. But even with the levees in place, people should continue to take whatever action they can to protect their property. In the Marion Gardens area, the entrance canal has been closed, and the levee work is progressing there. We'll have pumps there to keep the water pumped out as the need arises. Hopefully the levee work will also be extended into the Vintage Square area. Our utilities, water, sewer, and electric remain operational, and we are very optimistic that they will continue to do so. We've taken a lot of precautions there. We're pretty well prepared in that area. We again ask people not to put any extra water into the sewer system if they can avoid it, just so that we don't overload our pumps. We're okay, but we just want to take as much pressure off there as we can. Sandbags are available at both the Expo site and the Morris Manufacturing site. The National Guard has been doing a tremendous job, and our thanks goes out to them for what they've been doing with the sandbagging. As Mayor Gill mentioned, safety is very important, so please take the precautions to avoid anyone getting in or near the turbulent water, as this increased flow can be very dangerous. We urge people to stay out of the areas where construction is going on. We appreciate the fact that, for instance, Dennis Hansen at the Fort Pierre Livestock has canceled the sale for this week, and that takes a lot of pressure off some of the traffic areas, so we won't have as much congestion for the construction trucks to operate. So we appreciate that very much. We have in Fort Pier, we have a daily meeting at the courthouse in Fort Pier at 1 o'clock to meet with our local leaders to coordinate actions and deal with concerns. That's about all I have, is just take care, be aware of things, and use common sense when you're dealing with this high water. Thank you.
A couple things.
Governor would like to say just a couple more things, please.
I know some of the media that's covering this conference has viewers in the Dakota Dunes area, so I wanted to offer a couple of more specifics. Just a reminder to the residents of Dakota Dunes, they should have their possessions moved, home secured, and be out of those homes by tomorrow, by late tomorrow, June 2nd. They should expect to be away from their homes for as much as 2 months, because again, the elevated water releases will continue for many weeks. So again, those in the Dakota Dunes should have their property moved to higher elevation and their homes secured, and be making plans to be out of there by late Thursday, June 2nd, tomorrow. I also want to mention that I've had a conversation with Governor Terry Branstad from Iowa, and with his help, we are moving a road closure of I-29, southbound I-29, one lane was closed down in Iowa. We'll move that closure further into South Dakota and use that lane for truck traffic entering into the dunes. That will give us a new entry point. We're going to take down the interstate fence and use that as an entry point into the dunes adjacent to the Sioux River to build a levee there adjacent to the river. So those are a couple of items about Dakota Dunes that were important to the residents there.
Thank you, Mr. Bloom. We'll go to questions now for some structure for the situation. I'd like to start with the people in the room here in the EOC, and then after a few questions, we'll go to the phones and give you a chance.
Eric, Tony Mangan and KCCR. Can you tell us a little bit about the structure that you're talking about that on campground number 3, what that would do, and how, and do you need to have that done before you increase the releases from the dam?
We do not have to have it constructed before releases. We're just trying to do everything that we can to channelize that flow so that we can get it into the river before it spreads out downstream. So what it entails is basically opening up that old railroad grade a little bit more, and then just tie in that the training dike. We have a training dike meeting up to 1806 on the downstream side of that channel. We're just going to extend that, not as tall, same elevation as the roadway, downstream, so that we can control that water.
As you take a look at it, though, you know, Garrison has opened up their gates for the first time ever. Are you still hoping that the emergency spillway here in Pier, the Waukee Dam, will not have to be open? Is that still the priority?
Our priority is still to keep flows out of that spillway, and we're still looking that's going to happen. We're just planning for the contingency. There's nothing in this work that says we think we're going to be using it, but if God forbid something happens and we absolutely had to, we want to be as prepared as possible.
So you're grading the land from the highway from 1806 down through Campground 3, so the water...
It probably won't be clear down to Campground 3. We're going to start at the roadway and then just take a training dike down towards the river with the material that we're taking out of that railroad grade.
So it would not... The idea would be, is doing this, you would keep the water from rushing down Highway 1806, am I right?
That's essentially a good point, way to put it.
With levee progress on track, are you still planning, or is it still possible to release the water earlier?
I'm thinking right now the schedule is probably going to be as produced earlier. I think the initial increase will be Friday.
So what's the number of people that could be affected in Pier now? Is it still at 2,000, which was said earlier?
Yes.
That's still
the same.
Okay, thank you. And how about Dakota Dunes? How many people are down there in those homes?
You know, again, all I know is the number of residential structures in Dakota Dunes is about 1,100, and not all of them will be affected. There's, I have not counted, but the very uppermost, and I'm talking north as upper, the very uppermost areas probably will not be. Parts of Levee Trail will not be. Parts of Oxbow Trail will not be. Pawn Hollow, Bison Trail, but some parts of those streets will be affected. And so there might be, 20, 30, 100 to 200 houses that won't be affected at all. Some of those houses might get 6 inches of water up to their doors. And then as you get closer to the river, you're talking about feet. And also each house is hard to measure because you can measure the development and in its original site, and street grades are typically very well reported because contractors build streets according to specified elevation plans. But once you get to a house, a homeowner buys a lot, they might choose to elevate their house or not, and that kind of data is not collected and available in topographical maps very typically. So it's hard to evaluate even houses closer to. Some will be inundated, some will be impacted by more than being surrounded.
How many miles of levees?
Maybe.
Governor, if I can ask Charles Reagan from the public radio, if I can ask, how many miles of levees are being constructed at Dakota Dunes, and how far away are we from getting that completed?
I have that here. The levee that is being constructed is about 2 miles long. Again, it's in some ways it's like the Fort Pier levee. It twists and turns, and it's got trees to deal with and undulating terrain, and so it's a more difficult levee to be building. Some of the levee exists already. Much of it exists already, so it's a matter of raising it. But as you raise a levee, you must spread its base to make it strong enough. If you raise it simply vertically, it'll literally tip over, or the wall, the vertical wall will erode away. It must be a triangular shape in its cut section.
For the two mayors, you have talked about utilities being fine. You've talked about you believe those are in good shape at this point. In your mind, have you prepared for the worst case scenario that if there's a lot of water and we lose electricity and we lose lift station? I mean, do you have those worst case scenarios in place in case it does happen?
I think that we've hardened the protection adequately for our electric. And for most part, for our sewer setup, our water supply, of course, comes from Minnewatone, West River Lyman Jones Rural Water, and they're taking all the precautionary steps they need to get that supplied. So I think we're in pretty good shape in Fort Pier on the utilities.
And this is Pier Mayor Lori Gill, and in Pier, we've done the same thing with each one of the utilities. We've brought in technical assistance to review what we've got in place and what preventive measures we need to have in place. We've also had communication with other municipalities that have gone through flooding that have similar systems to us, and made sure that we've got the preventive things for each one of the utilities in place that we need to. So I feel confident that we've thought ahead, we've done some troubleshooting, and have things in place.
Any plans at this point to close the car bridge between Pier and Fort Pier, and structurally would it be able to hold under the currents?
I couldn't hear that.
It was a question about the integrity of the highway bridge and pier.
Oh, the question is, we should be able to maintain Highway 83 throughout.
Okay, one more question from here, and then I'll go to the phones.
It's the idea with the levees, when you say they're 95%, that's the 140 or 1434 level, right? And once you start releasing water on Friday, you'll continue to build up to the 1436, correct?
Actually, in Pier, there's a significant portion of those levees that are nearing that total top out, the 34 plus the 2.
Okay.
So
in Fort Pier, though, the idea is to get to the 34 before Friday and then build up to 36.
The contractor has another 48 hours of time. The water will raise some, but he can still work on those levees if need be. We're actually hoping that he's closer to the 36 by the end of tomorrow, and that's the goal. Obviously, we want to have him completely done, but we're working towards that end.
So they may not be completely at that 36, but they'll be close by.
That's what we're looking for.
Okay, I'm gonna go to the phones and see if anyone else on the phones has a few questions before we come back here.
Michelle Lank, Sioux City Journal.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me? Okay, I'm wondering, and residents in Dakota Dunes are wondering as well, if two things, if evacuation is mandatory, you talked about steps kind of going up toward the north end of the development. Is it mandatory? If so, what neighborhoods, and what will trigger a mandatory evacuation? And I know residents at the apartments are really confused. So if you could address those concerns, I'd appreciate it.
I will. First of all, everyone in the residential area should be prepared to evacuate by tomorrow night. That's what I said several days ago, and that remains true. They certainly should remove all their property now and move it to higher ground. They should secure their homes now if they have not already done so, and be prepared to evacuate personally by the end of tomorrow. The IMAT team in place is giving me a written evacuation plan that will address those questions today. And so by tomorrow, I will have the specifics. But in any case, everyone should be prepared to evacuate by tomorrow.
Governor, is that a mandatory evacuation?
It includes the apartments, I take it.
Where are the apartments?
They're right on I-29 at exit 1. Pretty high, it appears.
What street are they on?
Dakota, at the entrance street, Dakota Dunes Boulevard, but then there's probably a name for their little drive into the buildings. They're very close to Dakota Boulevard at I-29.
Yeah, I really can't tell where that is on the map without more specifics on the cross street.
I don't have that map in front of me. I will get it.
I tell you what, if you call the emergency operations center and ask for the PIO section, we'll see if we can get you an answer rather than take.
Okay.
Any other questions on the phones, please?
Yeah, Eric, I have a question for Eric with the Corps. Can you draw back a bit and talk about the stress on the whole river system? Is there any threat to the storage reservoirs above South Dakota? And then once you get below South Dakota, what's going to happen to St. Louis and the Mississippi when all that river, that water starts getting down there?
Well, as an entire system, we're all going through this together. As far up as Fort Peck, Montana, and the Fort Peck Dam, that reservoir is going to go into surcharge storage. They're actually going to raise the emergency spillway gates, and water is going to be at the top of the gates in a raised position. That's what we call surcharge. So it's actually the water elevation will be above the static, the normal top of emergency spillway gate elevation. The same thing is going to happen at Garrison. Because we have concerns at Oahe with our spillway flow, they're trying desperately to keep us below that elevation, so we will not raise our gates and surcharge at Oahe. And as you progress down the entire system, everyone's going to be passing this water. So as we pass this water, it's going to get to the river below the Gavis Point Dam into the open river reach, and all the people clear down towards St. Louis, and I'm sure it's going to influence the Mississippi also. It's a lot of water to move.
Other questions?
This is Jerry with KGFX. I'm just wondering if the last number that I saw for the National Guard soldiers in Pier and Fort Pier was about 620 on Monday. Are you expecting any more to come this way?
Not at this time. We may exchange some soldiers, but we'll maintain about those levels at this time.
This is Jeff Rankle with KMAG in Dakota Dunes. Question, we're hearing that from a lot of residents that they've been told that after 12 noon, approximately right now, that residents will not be allowed in and out of the dunes. If that be the case, how are folks supposed to meet these deadlines?
My instructions to the IMAT team down there, which is in control of the traffic, and I said this to them orally and I reinforced it this morning. The primary mission is to get the trucks in and out. That will protect the most property and lives. If we can get those levees to hold, we'll protect the most property, and certainly it'll affect lives, but it'll protect the most property and be the best solution. And they will be judging how they can allow residents in and out, and will give opportunities as best they can, so long as it does not restrain the ability of the contractor to get in and out and build the levees. Yesterday, when I was on the levee with the contractor, at one point he stated that traffic was causing him to be able to dump half as much as he could otherwise dump. That's unacceptable. And so we need to drill down and manage that traffic so we get the job done. And if people did not heed my warning several days ago and act, I'm sorry. But I asked them to begin immediately. And so we need to do what we need to do to get these levees done. In the end, everyone in the dunes will benefit if we succeed. If we fail, the individual protective measures are certainly important, but their ability to deal with the solution for 2 months is much less effective than the levees would be. Surround your house with sandbags for 2 months, and if the power goes off and you've got a sandy base, you've got water in the house regardless. If you can hold that levee, if you can keep interior pumps that are managing the water within the whole development, dewatering the development, then everyone's home benefits. So if there are property owners that are unhappy about the way we're regulating traffic, we are responding to the situation as we find it. And that's why I led with the fact that this development was designed to constrict traffic and to slow it, and we need the opposite.
Other phone questions?
Governor?
Yes.
Frank Kolchek, representative from Scotland. I just want to commend you for bringing the 842nd home, and the Paul Scherzlick and the crew in Yankton, they're doing an outstanding job. We've been making bags with them and then putting some out in the homes. It has been brought to my attention that plastic must be put around the homes first, before the sandbags. I have three easy questions for you. One is the heavy equipment coming back with the 842nd? Number two is the Standing Bear Bridge. How long will that be closed? And then the Riverside Acres and the flooding down below Sacred Heart Hospital. And then the final question is the dam spillway breakage, wall breakage down at Fort Randall. How severe is that on the spillway wall? I understand there's some breakage and some cement work to be done on that.
Senator Kolchek, this is Tony Benheisen. I'll give you a call right after this brief to answer those questions.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to go back to the EOC for a couple more questions before we wrap this up. Chet, I think I put you off for a while.
Governor, it sounds as if you expect you're going to have to issue some mandatory evacuations. Is that correct?
I think it's very possible. Again, I want a proposal from law enforcement in this area and from the IMAT team down in the dunes area, and then I'll react to that proposal. It's not a black and white thing. You have to deal with time. You have to deal with phases. There, as I said, there are some areas where the water inundation will be modest, and human safety is not so much a concern as access of vehicles in and out. In other areas closer to the river, human safety will definitely be a concern, and that risk rises day by day as the release schedule is implemented. And so, and then you have to consider once the river is up to 150 cubic feet per second and the levees where they're constructed are holding, if they are holding, then to what degree will we allow entry and exit? So those considerations have to be dealt with, and we also have to talk about communicating to the people, how we'll communicate. So that's a comprehensive plan that's being put together. We're going to detail it this afternoon and implement it probably or announce it in the next day.
Governor, I just want to make sure you are thinking, you know, I know you've been talking about mandatory evacuations down at Dakota Dunes, but in your mind, there might be that here in Pier 4, am I correct?
Yes, there might be.
And you'll know within a day, you said?
I'll know what our plan is within a day.
Are you feeling, you know, I know you've been talking about that possibility, and all of you, about the evacuation since last week. Do you feel as strongly now as you did then that there would have to be evacuations? Or have you never wavered that you thought that eventually there would have to be evacuations?
In Pier Fort Pier. At the time the questions were asked earlier, it was more a definition of whether I was ordering evacuation at the time because I was urging people to evacuate their homes. And you can take that more than one way. You could take that as get your property out, clear out your home, or get your person out. The safest thing is both. Now, at what stage does it make sense to get all your property out? Well, it takes a long time to get property out, so you need to implement that more quickly. At what stage must we have personal bodies out? That can be done more quickly if one's physically able, but certainly communicating it is also a time vampire. So at some point we're going to have to demand that all those at risk remove themselves, because although one is responsible for one's own life to the extent that people remain within a danger zone and then are depending upon emergency responders to risk their lives in case of medical or other emergencies, that is not acceptable. Especially when the risk is as great and as predictable as it is today.
Joe, one last question for me. What percentage of the levees is completed in Dakota Dunes? How far do we have to go to get those levees in?
We have a long ways to go at Dunes, but we have a longer period before we must expect higher releases. And I am not going to recite progress because that would be very speculative on my part. Lieutenant Governor Michaels is down there. We're working with the contractor. Much like it was on Sunday and Monday in Pier, the contractor was rapidly ramping up, and that's what's occurring. Again, the Blackhawks just got there yesterday late afternoon. The contractor is ramping up yesterday and will do more so today. We had traffic issues. We're going to get rid of some of those issues. So what happens when you announce completion, people start to do simple arithmetic, and it's not simple arithmetic in this case. So I really can't tell you that with any great accuracy.
We're going to take one more question, and then we should really let these people get back to some other things, if you don't mind. Who's got one last question here? Anyone? If not, tomorrow at 11 a.m. we'll have another briefing. I'll issue you a media advisory on that, and thanks a lot for taking the time and your patience waiting for us.